Dr. Giles Yeo, welcome.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me back. Thank you for having
me
back.
Yeah, you've been on this show before. We've been talking about genes and food and nutrition.
Yeah.
But now you say that we shouldn't be counting calories.
That's right.
But why have we been counting calories for? I mean, many people have. I'm looking at you. Sorry.
Yeah. I've been counting. I admit it.
Yeah, people have been counting.
They've been counting. People have been counting calories for 120 years. Now, look, can I just, before people start chucking pears at me, let me explain. Clearly, 200 calories of potato chips is going to be twice the portion of 100 calories of potato chips. That is obvious. But so is 200 grams of potato chips, twice the portion of 100 grams of potato chips. You're not going to be comparing 200 grams of potato chips to 200 grams of carrots. Now, so it's not quite that extreme, but that is the problem. People, we worship the calorie, we do. We count it for 120 years. We talk about calories and cutting it and food. But we eat food. We don't actually eat calories. We eat food, and then our body takes the calories out of the food. And that is what I'm trying to say. I didn't invent any of this. I'm just
yes, but why does it say how many? Because this, on every package or box or whatever, you can read the amount of calories.
That's it.
Why is that? Why do we need that information?
Oh, why do we need the information? Yeah. So I think you have to have a little bit of a history lesson. So without boring and not boring anyone, anyone silly. But there was a guy named Wilbur Atwater from between 1880 and 1900. This is how old the science is. And he was interested, when we eat food, let's put it this way. He understood the sweet corn scenario. The sweet corn scenario is when you eat sweet corn on the cob, and then you look in the loo the next day, it's quite clear you haven't absorbed the sweet corn. It's come out. So he was, Atwater was very interested in trying to understand, well, how much, when we ate a food, how much did we actually absorb? And so this is what he did for 20 years, right? Think about this before we complain about our jobs. I just want to point out. So what he did for 20 years was in order to calculate calories in food, you burn the food and you measure the temperature that's come off. That's pretty much it. So he burnt lots of food, carrots, steak, chips, whatever it is. He actually burnt it in what we call a bomb calorimeter. He burnt it in a sealed container, and around the sealed container is water with a thermometer in it. And literally, how much, because one calorie is the amount of energy it takes to raise 1 liter of water 1 degree Celsius at sea level. That's one calorie. That's what a calorie means. And so he just burnt lots of food and measured the temperature. Then he fed the food to people, and then he then burnt their poo. Okay? And so for 20 years he did this, exactly. So now he knows how much energy there is in food, how much energy came out the other side, one minus the other, and then you can say, well, how much energy we absorbed. And he came up with the famous numbers. They're called the Atwater factors, which is 4 calories for every gram of protein, 4 calories for every gram of carb, and 9 calories for every gram of fat in 1900. And all of the calorie counts on every single package of food are based on those three numbers, the prediction.
So he's to blame for all this information that we really don't need.
I think, is it true that the vast burden of non-infectious disease, we are in the middle of an infectious disease problem at the moment, of non-infectious disease, is it true that it's diet related? Okay, you know, yes, obesity, type 2 diabetes. And so I think having information about food on the packaging is probably a good thing, and how much you might be eating.
But is a calorie, whatever it is, whatever kind of food it is?
It isn't, and I think that's the problem. I mean, a calorie is a calorie once it's in you, like a little poof of energy. Okay, that is exactly the same. But just let me give you an example, all right? Because we eat the food, and then our body has to work to get out the calories, I'll just give you an example from protein, okay? So if you have 100 calories of protein, and this is gonna be what you see on the side of the pack, we are only ever able to use 70 calories, 70 of the 100. 30 calories is burnt, used to process the protein in our body. So if you look, protein calories are 30% wrong on every single packet everywhere. So I think information is useful. Of course it is. I want to know how much we want to eat. But it's got to be the right information, I think. And so a calorie of, I don't know if you guys know this, but a calorie of protein makes you feel fuller than a calorie of fat, than
example,
a calorie of
carb. What could that be?
So if you actually, so purely, clearly we don't eat protein, carbs, and fat, we eat food. But if you had 100 calories of steak, yeah, okay, versus 100 calories of fried pig skin, I love fried pig skin, mm. okay, versus 100 calories of chips, all right? The steak, 100 calories, is going to make you feel fuller than the fat, which is going to make you feel fuller than the carb. Now, exactly 100 calories. And so in that specific scenario, if you then end up eating food that is slightly higher in protein, it will make you feel fuller, even though you're eating exactly the same number of calories. So that's why calories don't count.
So that's why it's irrelevant in a way.
It is irrelevant. It's relevant in a sense as energy, but I think there is a better way of putting the stuff we need on the side of the pack than just the pure calories.
Yeah, what you talk about is you have food, mm-hmm. you have processed food, mm-hmm. and you have ultra-processed food. Mm-hmm. Explain that difference.
Okay, so
examples.
Most food we eat, I would say nearly all food we eat is processed in some way, aside from you maybe walking down and plucking an apple off the tree and eating. So that's not in process. But the meat would have been diced and sliced in some way. We cook it, okay, that's a process. We ferment it, we make yogurt, we make bread. That's all processed. So when people bag on, the people like are rude about processed foods, you gotta say, well, no, processed foods have kept us alive because we cook it, we you know, do all kinds of things. Ultra processed foods, and this is a modern phenomenon, is very different because it involves industrial processes that we are not able to replicate in a domestic kitchen, or for that matter, a restaurant. So, for example, when you go to famous fast food restaurants and order little chicken nuggety things, okay, those are made from what they call extruded chicken, which sounds delicious. It's really nice. So it's not poisonous. It's not, none of this is poisonous, but you take the carcass.
So it's not a piece of chicken that's only, I mean, it's...
No, it's not. So at home, yeah, exactly. You would slice a piece of chicken, yeah. And you know that because they're all different shapes and sizes. Now, when you go to such famous restaurants and look at it, they come in two shapes. How can chicken come in two shapes? okay, unless it's been formed into two shapes. And so what happens is they take the carcass I'm not meant to put people off, I'm sorry, but the of a chicken, after you take off the premium cuts, the breast, the leg, the wings, you know, the stuff that we normally eat, they then force the chicken through a very small sieve. They kind of force everything through, and everything that's left, some of it is meat, nerves, so animal-based protein. They then sort of heat it up to kill stuff, and then they kind of spritz some stuff on it to make sure it's palatable, and then you get this white slime. Then they reform the white slime. They then coat it because all the flavor's been taken out now, right? There's no flavor. You then have to add flavor. Where does flavor come from? Flavor comes from the Holy Trinity. Sugar, salt, and fat. Okay, then you add that back in, okay, for that.
But you have now, something chickenish here.
Chickenish. Just a chicken of chicken provenance. And then you do it, you then deep fry it. And that's it. So that's an example, right? You're not going to do this at home. You don't have the equipment to do it. And at
this,
home, you
I had this yesterday. Oh.
it's his favorite dish, the thing you're talking about.
I mean, this is what you feed your kids.
No, but he asks for it, you know. Yesterday, I actually got it, but now I feel really bad.
A couple of things, because I don't want to get sued. They're not poisonous. It's perfectly, you know, it's fine for you. You're not going to, no one's going to die from eating it. The major issue with it, and it is very palatable. It's so tasty because they've constructed the flavor. They have constructed the flavor because what that slime doesn't have any flavor, okay? And so because it's so nice and you dip it into the sauce and it's really delicious, the problem is...
It's still slime.
only because I described it as such. I'm going to get into so much trouble for this.
Sorry.
I'm going to go. But it's not that we eat it that's the problem. Is that we eat too much of it. So in Northern...
Not anymore.
Not... I'm in so much trouble. On a serious note, in the higher income countries, so in most of the countries in Northern Europe, for example, we get more than 50% of our calories from ultra-processed foods. So the issue isn't having a treat. Isn't having and going out and having the odd thing and really enjoying it and saying, this is so nice. It hits the brain and fires all the right circuits in the brain. Woo, right? And the problem is we are using it as our base fuel now. We're getting so much of it. That is the issue.
But surely we don't eat that much of this kind of food in Scandinavia. After all, we're Scandinavians. Or
because you're square jawed and do biathlon.
That's my image. No, I'm thinking that we're kind of now we're in Britain. It's all over the place this kind of food. But I'm thinking we're so healthy.
But any food from a packet, by its very definition, any food. I'm thinking about poo. Burning poo.
I know
exactly. My son, actually, do you know what's funny? And I'll get back to the story. I promise you. When my son was 6 years old in primary school, and you know, in the primary school, you go and it's like prison, right? You take maybe they don't do this in Scandinavia, but in schools here, you have the metal plate, then it goes. Okay, and so it was chicken nugget day in the school, and so but my wife has drilled this into him. Okay, she says there is poo in the nuggets. There's poo in the nuggets. There is not. Okay, and so he's six, and there's a dinner lady putting the food on the tray, and says chicken nuggets. My mom says there's poo. We ended up getting called by the school because there's that there is no poo in the food. Anyway, that's terrible. I'm going.
That's what you should say.
Okay, what are you doing? You're getting our son into trouble. So, anything that is packaged is going to be ultra processed. I mean, I think part of the problem.
So anything that's packaged is ultra processed. Okay. So anything in my freezer would probably be ultra processed.
Yes, that is going to be true.
Because fish, meat, vegetables.
No. Okay. So clearly, if you buy a frozen fish fillets, fish fingers are going to be ultra processed. But if you actually buy frozen fish fillets or frozen chicken, that's just chicken that's been frozen. But I'm talking about the stuff that is actually something has been done to it. They've wrapped it in bread. They've done something to it. So anything of those sorts will, by its very definition, be ultra processed. Now, not all ultra-processed foods are the same. And I think that's a critical thing, because if you take yogurt, for example, if you have plain yogurt, that's just natural yogurt, that's just processed. If you, however, have we have a famous yogurt here, I'm not going to name the company, which comes in squares, and there's a triangle, and then right, the one side is one side is and the other side. So suddenly it does become ultra-processed, because you're now introducing something else to the whole system. Okay, and that is, so not all ultra-processed foods are clearly going to be extruded from a chicken carcass, you know.
As an example, I'm trying to drink less milk in my coffee, use less milk in my coffee. So I
why?
Because I'm.
If I might ask.
I'm getting older, and you know the fat comes from behind. So I try to stay kind of slim.
I understood.
It's the milk in the coffee that
I think is the milk in the coffee. This is a private matter.
Not the fish fingers.
let me decide. But the thing is that, so as I like that in the morning, I switched with some oat milk.
Yep.
What do you call it? Yeah, oat milk.
Oat milk, yep.
And I'm so happy with that. But now I realize that's probably processed. Ultra-processed, or?
It is, okay. It is ultra-processed, but as long as you know what it is, and at the end of the day, a little bit of oat milk and coffee is not going to kill you, but do you know how they make
oat milk? It's not going to kill me, but I have more than that.
I mean, do you know how they make oat milk? I mean,
well, in my head, it's like they have a lot of oat.
Yes.
And they sort of milk press.
You didn't milk the oat?
I have no idea.
You didn't milk the oat? No, I mean...
Milk oat, no.
Okay, I'll tell the process. The process is this, right? Because obviously, in order to convert the... Because, you know, you can take oat milk, you can froth it up for cappuccinos, and it tastes like... It tastes almost like milk, the fatty feeling. It tastes quite nice. I do like oat milk as well. But in order to achieve that, and this is the problem, right? In order to achieve that, you first need to soak the oats to get the white color, that because that's milk color. But then that's it. If you try drinking that, that is not very tasty at all. And so now you need the fatty flavor. And so the fatty flavor is made using rapeseed oil. And so they then put in enough rapeseed oil so that when you emulsify it, it then has the milky type feeling on the tongue. Now, an oat has pretty much no nutrients otherwise. So now you now have to say, except for white water. So now you have white water and fat. Now let's make it nutritious, otherwise you're not going to get anything from it. So then you fortify it. You put iron, you put some protein in, you put vitamins, you put anything. So you put powder, right? And then you put some emulsifiers so that when you actually the whole thing up, it doesn't split. When you put your oat milk, it's not fat that comes out first, and then the white water, it comes out like milk. And that's because they put the emulsifiers. Now and then you go woo, and then you get oat milk. So one's gonna have me on the program again.
Another pleasure taken away.
Yeah. No, but
it's gonna be black coffee from now on.
Yeah, it is.
No, but there are some. Look. Once again, I am gonna get myself into a real lot of trouble. There's nothing wrong with it as long as you know where it comes from, and the interesting thing about a lot of the plant-based, the vegan foods that are available is that most of them. Almost, okay, aside from eating vegetables and eating beans, those are obviously, that's. But when you actually buy prepackaged stuff, when you buy those pretend meat burgers, you know how you can now have burgers that, plant-based burgers
yeah,
that bleed?
Yeah.
That bleed? By its very definition, if you can make a plant bleed, there's some processing that's happening,
yeah.
Right? It's not beetroot, right? And so what always interests me is when we talk about ultra-processed foods and I describe, for example, what we talk about or cheap burgers or pizzas, everyone go, ooh, it's terrible, ick, right? And then you speak to the Instagram food gurus, you would never catch an Instagram food guru taking a picture, here's my nugget, here's my pizza. They wouldn't. Whereas they would do it with oat milk, with oats. They would do it with, here is my faux meat burger. And I just think that not all ultra-processed foods are the same. And I fear that there is a halo of health around some of the plant-based and vegan ultra-processed foods out there, which it's ultra-processed foods with good PR, okay? Mm. And I think...
So I see, and of course, ultra-processed food also has calories in it, and so the problem is still there.
The problem is, it's not only that they have calories in it. Okay, what is the problem with ultra-processed foods? Before I'm stop bagging under my promise. Ultra-processed foods are inherently, because of what goes into it, inherently lower in protein and fiber, inherently. And higher in salt, sugar, and fat because there's no flavor and you've got to add it in. So because it's lower in protein and fiber, the calories are very, very available. So in other words, if you have a steak, just as an example, 400 calories of a steak, and you eat it, you'll get 70% of the calories from there in the steak. Whereas if you actually have a steak that's been minced up, heated for 8 hours, stuck into a lasagna, you know, and everything like that, and actually been ultra-processed, you get a lot more than 400 calories out of the steak. You get a lot more than 400 calories. So in other words, the calories are more available, and that is the issue. So 400 calories of an ultra-processed food is very different from 400 calories of a whole food. You get a lot more calories out of them than if you just ate a whole food.
How?
Can I ask a personal question as well?
What are you thinking?
No, I mean, since you asked about the milk, can I ask about the food that I am hooked on now? It's like these sardines in olive oil. Is that processed? Because I only eat that at the time.
Sardines in olive oil?
Sardiner I olje, yeah.
Yes, that's sardines in olive oil.
Yeah.
No, but that's just tin fish. That's fish that's been caught.
So that's a good
and
thing.
And then preserved.
Okay.
Yeah, like a lot of canned food, you know, are not necessarily going to be ultra-processed. Because if you buy, for example, canned tin beans or the sweet corn, so there's a very big difference between, because that's preservation. It's like having jam, it's like having pickles, it's like having anything. That's okay, because it's preserved.
But I wonder, keep on eating your sardine. Eating has become very complicated.
It has.
Let's agree on that.
It has. It shouldn't be, but it has.
It has, because you really don't know what you're eating.
Mm-hmm.
What if we just didn't care and just ate, just chilled, eat what we want, and like a dog would do if we had the access.
He doesn't understand the question.
So,
no, but I mean, it has a psychological side.
It does have a psychological side, and just to be crystal clear, I'm not telling anyone to fear food. This is not. I'm just trying to get people to understand the food they're eating. Okay, there is inherently nothing wrong with ultra-processed foods. We eat too much of it. There's inherently nothing wrong with foods that are high in fat if you don't eat too much of it. Because, you know, even if you eat too many carrots, you can get yourself poisoned from eating too many carrots. For example, you turn yourself orange, right? Right? I mean, so literally, and that's terrible. You don't want to be orange.
She tried, with carrots. She broke a tooth.
So I think it is the question of eating too much rather than fearing the food. And that we are designed to work within the food environment that we're in, right? And it's we have changed our food environment so much over the past 30 years. So people that go on the paleo diet, for example, okay? And the paleo diet, as people says, we should eat like cavemen because we are not used to agriculture. So that is not actually true. Because you're able to drink milk. Cavemen were not able to drink milk, for example. Because we've had 15,000...
They only had oat milk.
They only had oat milk. They only had oats. And very little of that. In order to actually... But we've had 10,000 years to actually adjust to agriculture. We've had 20 or 30 years to adjust to ultra-processed foods, and we haven't been able to... So I don't think we can just say, go nuts. Just one more thing about ultra-processed foods, which is really, really interesting. I have a friend of mine in Yale, Professor Dana Small in Yale, and she did this study, okay? She was interested in how human beings, and she's a psychiatrist, a psychologist, and so she was interested in how human beings, why did they like sort of ultra-processed foods as much as they did? And so she got people to try and predict how much calories there were in foods that were higher in fat, higher in carbs, or high in fats and carbs mixed together. Okay, so she tried to do that. Now, it turns out that human beings are very good at judging how many calories there are in fat. They are less good at judging how much calories there are in carbs, and they have no idea, zero idea, when you mix fat and carbs together. Okay, like zero idea. So that's the first thing. The second thing is then she scanned their brains while they're doing it. And when you eat fat, when you eat carbs, when you eat fat and carbs, whoop, whoop. I mean, it's like it's supercharged. And then when you actually then think about it, why would this be the case? Because foods that are naturally high in fat and carbs, this is not deep frying something, because that doesn't exist.
Could this be
nature.
Like ice cream?
Ice cream, pasta, pastry, chocolate, everything that tastes nice.
Yeah, I go here.
Whoop. Whoop, whoop. Exactly, everything that tastes nice. And it doesn't occur naturally. We've put it together. One of the only foods that exists naturally that is high in fat and carbs together is milk, okay? And so you can imagine a baby mammal, whoop, out comes a baby mammal. What's the role? The baby mammal has to grow as quickly as possible so that it can stop becoming tiger food, okay? So this is aim. And so it looks for milk, and it drinks, and it gets it in. So I think part of the problem with these ultra-processed foods, which are high in fat and carbs mixed together, is this, the hypothesis, as I don't, you know, obviously you can't prove it, is that we're trying to find the primal, our primal food, our milk, from when we were small again. So it lights up our brain like a Christmas tree.
Giles, it's been wonderful to talk to you again, and hope you enjoyed the clip. For more interesting conversations, please hit subscribe.